Good afternoon. My name is Lisa Balsera with USF Health. Thank you so much for joining us today as we continue our Facebook Live series in health and wellness. We're delighted to be here today with Dr. Rafael Carrion. Thanks so much for your time today.
Well, thank you again for this invitation.
Sure. And Dr. Carrion is a professor of urology at USF and program director for men's health and also obviously urology. And this month is Men's Health Awareness Month. So there's obviously a great expert here in that field. So Dr. Carrion, will you tell us a little bit about prostate health and some of the dietary concerns around that? And I know there's been a lot of research in that area.
There's been a lot of research, and it only highlights what is really what I consider a systemic concept. there's no replacing good general healthy lifestyle, and that's even more emphasized when it comes to prostate health. So some of the literature points in the direction. We don't have hard evidence, and that's why we can't come out with a specific diet, but we do have general recommendations pointing in the direction of eating. Fruits and vegetables are substantially beneficial to the prostate health and the actual intricate tissues that make up the prostate gland. Also as well, certain healthy lipids, if you will, such as salmon. Mm-hmm. So salmon, fruits, vegetables, and if you want to get into a little more nitty gritty, things like lycopene in tomatoes. I mean, some of these have been earshot, if you will, to provide excellent adjuncts and nutritional factors for optimizing prostate gland tissue.
Excellent. And yearly exams for men for prostate health?
That is a great question. Mm-hmm. We always get asked, when do I need it to get checked? Oh, I heard in the news that, you know, we really don't have to have it checked anymore. And for the most part, most protocols still accepted nationwide is about 45 to 50 begins some of the conversations with your primary care physician in getting your prostate checked. 50 is a good barometer. If you've had no family history of any prostate issues, especially prostate cancer, so at a 50 age landmark, if a patient comes to see a urologist, even for a different reason, it's very classic to have your prostate checked manually as well as potentially a blood exam as well.
Okay, and then that's up to you, the discretion for that PSA test. I know there's some dialogue around that.
Absolutely. So before, there was very little protocols in terms of guiding the provider as to when to get that PSA, and so we were getting PSAs on everyone at any timeline. Now it's gauged into a more orderly fashion, and you're using more or less the same protocols. But keep in mind, it's meant to keep you safe, and you're screening that 50 to 75-year-old. That's prime time for the male species, and so you really want, that's a high-yield age parameter. So it's, if you have family history, you can validate screening at the age of 45. No family history of prostate cancer, you can start getting that PSA at the age of 50.
Okay. And as far as technological advances in your field, what are you most excited about of late?
I think there's a lot in prostate health and men's health in general in terms of optimizing who are the ones that are going to develop prostate cancer. In other words, divide the pool as to who are higher risk patients versus lower risk so that they're not undergoing unnecessary screening. And then the second thing, especially for the rest of the prostate health, is how do you identify keeping the prostate healthy enough so that you don't have other common ailments, such as weaker urinary stream, wake up at night to pee, some of these things that are just common, routine, bothersome symptoms. How do we optimize things? And I do believe we're heading in a direction following other disciplines where we play a more active role in preventive medicine. Mm-hmm. Right now, we're simply reactionary. Mm-hmm. Once something's wrong with the prostate, we're trying to treat it. Why not optimize preventive medicine? So I do believe in terms of not just prostate cancer prevention, but also even preventing bothersome plumbing or voiding symptoms such as an enlarged prostate as well.
Gotcha. And so what are some other things you talked about? Diet. What are some other things that you talk to your patients about on a regular basis?
So to optimize prostate health, you can't cheat. It really is system health. And with system health, not only is eating a well-balanced diet, a nutritional diet for your system, same thing applies to your body mass index. Mm-hmm. Your basic physical prototype is critical to optimizing your health. And what that means is you have to exercise. Mm-hmm. You have to exercise, you have to maintain good body shape, because that indirectly affects our plumbing system. A nice nickname for urologists is we are plumbers. And for the plumbing in a system to work well, you want that system to be ideal. So exercise is fundamental. And don't forget, if we're also gonna tie into that Men's Health Month, it also helps hormonally. Mm-hmm. A man who exercises gets a better release with testosterone and certain other elements that are positive in this equation.
That's great advice. What's some other research that you've been involved with? I know you've done extensive research that's really excited about.
If you bridge the gap and focus on more areas, especially within my sexual medicine domain, they're making things more optimal for that patient who's suffering from any element of sexual dysfunction, whether it's orgasmic dysfunction, whether it's the classic erectile dysfunction. And so they're making current modalities safer, like getting a penile implant, mm-hmm. with all its risks. They're finding ways to make the implants more foolproof, safer to put in, and decrease the risk of infections. And if there is something that goes wrong, now there's newer technology that helps save the situation, if you will. Mm-hmm. When it comes to pills and in early first-line therapy, we're also finding interesting data, and the data is emerging with new modalities out there to try to see, is there also new things that isn't necessarily a pill, like a Viagra pill, mm-hmm. or a penile implant? Is there something else out there? And there are new modalities being studied as we speak. Now, unfortunately, it takes a little bit of a lag, but it's already out there being utilized in humans. So we only have to wait.
Okay, that's excellent news. And I know we have a surgery center. We're in the Mosani Center right now. Is that where you do some of your procedures?
Or? Right. So in this center, we're able to not only see patients in clinic, but we're also able to do outpatient surgical procedures on the second floor.
Okay, excellent. And then you also see patients at Tampa General and downtown?
Correct. Mm-hmm. I am part of the Department of Urology, so I happen to see patients and do surgeries both in the north side here and south in STC, mm-hmm. and my partners also divide accordingly as well.
Okay, excellent. Michelle, did we have any questions come in today?
I think one of the big questions is probably women, most of their lives, their adult lives, go to a gynecologist. Men don't go to a urologist unless there's a problem. So what kind of conversation would you like to have with men right here, right now, talking to them about when should they start to go to a urologist? Should you go in your 20s just to make sure everything's good? Should you keep going every couple of years, once a year, just when you have a problem? What would you recommend?
That's a great question, because in the general public, most don't even know what a urologist is until you're forced to go by typically another physician. Now, it is a surgical subspecialty, so it doesn't grab the primary care flavor a gynecologist has on the female gender patients. But a urologist could easily play that same role. And in fact, some of the models from public health sector and general medicine sectors show, should that urologist play that pseudo primary care role? Because many times I'm seeing an erectile dysfunction patient who's never seen a family doctor in the past 6 years, but had intimacy issues, finally sees me, and I'm diagnosing the high blood pressure, the diabetes, and have to quickly ramp in reverse. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, that's a great question. Now, the actual guidelines, there's no hard numbers, unfortunately, but they are catching up. There are no hard numbers to say at the age of 30, if you've not seen a urologist, you probably should get a general checkup. The reason why is there's overlap with the primary care arena. The primary care arena can adequately assess basic urologic domains. But again, it's being debated as we speak. Why? Because it's a generalized men's wellness forum. And so with that, urologists is postulated to play a bigger role. So there's no way to give an accurate hard number recommendation, but it's being disputed as we speak.
For breast cancer, we have the BRCA test that we do for breast cancer. are they going to come up with something like that, that someone in their 20s or 30s that has a family history could also have some type of prostate type BRCA testing as well?
Yeah, so they're definite. The new frontier in prostate cancer is really screening and risk assessment. So they're really trying to find out who are the ones that are going to need attention, and rightly so. And those that don't need that attention, not allocate the resources that are badly needed for those that do. And so with that, there are a lot of genomic testing being utilized in clinic as we speak, and a lot on the frontier. There is no foolproof way right now to assess a 20-year-old or a 30-year-old as to what is your definite risk. There are lots of algorithms and calculations being utilized, but there is nothing definite yet in a similar fashion.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Dr. Carrion.
Well, thank you again.